So welcome everybody.
I'm happy to be here and host you at this ERIGrid webinar. This is a joint effort of several partners of the ERIGrid project. My name is Panos Kotsampopoulos, and we're working together with Georg Laus, Efren Gouillos-Ansano, Ron Brandl, Van Hoa Nguyen, and Marios Maniatopoulos. Just as an introduction, the ERIGrid project is funded by the European Commission and aims to develop an integrated research infrastructure for smart grid systems. And in this framework, we are having a series of educational activities, which include some workshops, summer schools, webinars, remote access to our laboratory, and presentations that we have uploaded on our website. So afterwards, if you would like to have a look at our website and see if something is interesting for you, you are welcome to do this. Okay, so the topic of today is power hardware in the loop simulations. At first, we're going to discuss the main characteristics of it, then some stability accuracy issues, interface topologies and stabilization methods. We will then show the experience of the ERIGrid partners and show some tests that show the value of the approach, with DER inverters providing ancillary services, etc. Then we will show what we are currently doing at the ERIGrid project concerning hardware in the loop. We will also perform a live demonstration of hardware in the loop tests and leave some space for discussion. So in general, what is hardware in the loop? Basically, it is a combination of simulation and hardware. As we can see in this figure, we can have a simulation of a power system, as usually, but we also connect some hardware components externally. We can have power components, for example, PV inverters or whole microgrids, but we can also have control components, for example, centralized controllers for doing some optimizations, or relays, or controllers of inverters, etc. So, according to a classification made some years ago by the CAPS FSU in Florida in the US, there are two types of hardware in the loop: controller hardware in the loop and power hardware in the loop. At the first case, a controller is tested, and only the digital analog and analog digital converters are enough so in order to test the controller. And the other category is power hardware in the loop, which is used for testing a hardware power component. And in this case, also a power interface is necessary in order to amplify the low-level signal coming from the real-time simulator. And also a sensor is needed so that it can measure the response of the hardware and send it back to the simulator so that you have a closed-loop system. In the ideal situation, when we are doing testing or also want to study some phenomena, we would have the full system in front of us. However, this is not easy to do, but basically we can very rarely do it. And therefore, in practice, we use component hardware testing when we want to test a component. And when we want to study a phenomena in the large scale, we perform some pure simulation methods. The thing with the issue with the experimental setups is the low flexibility, the cost, the maintenance, and the possibility of damage. Moreover, when we do these tests in the lab, the conventional tests, for example, according to standards, some predefined profiles are applied and the complex interactions are not taken into account. On the other hand, concerning the pure simulation methods, where when we apply in order to study some phenomena, there are the issues the advantages are that we have some flexibility and low cost, but the results depends on the accuracy of the models. And now that we have the increased DG integration and the smart grids, things are becoming more complex and the reliability of simulation is becoming more difficult. So why do we need to do PHIL for power system analysis and testing? We think that this method supports the development of prototypes and innovative methods and technologies. It combines the advantages of simulation and hardware testing. Lab-based investigations are closer to field testing. And in this way, we can support the validation of simulation results. As we will see in the next slides, the approach can even show interactions that are not visible in digital simulation. Field testing can be de-risked, but on the other hand, it needs a relatively high implementation effort, and the accuracy and realism needs to be proven. So in this case, in this example, we have the basic voltage divider circuit with a voltage source, a simulated impedance, and a hardware impedance. And we want to apply the to apply it in the power hardware in the loop in the power hardware in the loop approach. So the voltage of the simulation is amplified. We can see the this is the transfer function of the amplifier, which consists of a time delay and the transfer function of the filter of the amplifier. Afterwards, this voltage is applied to the hardware impedance. So there is a current flowing on the hardware. And we need to measure this current with this current source in this case. And we apply it back to the simulation, to the real-time simulation, so that we can have this closed loop operation. So if we write down all the equations of the system, and it's just simply simple mathematics, we can derive the block diagram of the system. And from this, we can derive the open loop transfer function that is typically used for analyzing the stability of the system. So as this is a closed loop system with some where there are some delays and errors present, there are some cases where instability can occur. And there are several ways to examine this. The most straightforward way is to use the Nyquist plot, which can be implemented on software. Another approach which has been proposed by ERIGrid is to use the both the stability criterion. Another standard approach is the use of the Ruth criterion. However, this needs an approximation of the time delay, which is a polynomial approximation. Typically, the Padé approximation is used. So this is a disadvantage. Also, the root locus can be used, but which shows a graphical representation according to when a variable changes its values. And there is also the possibility of doing a dynamic simulation. For example, you can do this in the software like Simulink, or in the software of the of your real-time simulator, where when you represent all the components and the interactions. For example, you can see here the voltage source, the impedance of the hardware, the impedance of the software. Then this voltage is measured, it is amplified, it is applied on the hardware, we measure the current, etc. So basically you represent everything there and see what happens. So if what you see, so if you see the that the voltage goes to infinity, then of course you have instability. So now I will give the microphone to my colleague Georg Laus from the Austrian Institute of Technology, who will tell you more, give you more information on the stability.
Yes, thank you very much, Panos. So my name is Georg Laus from AIT, Austrian Institute of Technology, and I will present you the next three, four slides for regarding stability issues of power hardware in the loop simulation. And as you can see on this slide, there are always impedances involved for different types of stability analysis. So first of all, it has to be mentioned that power hardware in the loop systems can be modeled in a continuous time discrete way, or in a continuous or in a time discrete way. So you have always to deal with Thevenin equivalence regarding voltage sources and impedances, and those impedances that characterize your complete system. Based on this modeling approach, what we usually use and what is valid for using, if you look at experiences in the past, you can take those impedances and evaluate the open loop transfer function of the closed loop system. So I've depicted here two diagrams of the locus of the open loop transfer function of the closed loop PHL system, where you can see if impedance of the hardware is bigger than the software, which is on the left, then the system is unstable. So you can see it quite easily when the Nyquist point minus one plus J zero is encircled. And if not, so if the Nyquist plot is fine, is not encircling the Nyquist point, then you have stability. So what you see in the next slide is, here we go, the regarding analysis, you have to use assumptions just like the voltage amplifier and a current measurement, and analyze their or identify the transfer function. So TVA means transfer function for the voltage amplifier, and ME for measurement equipment. For ideal systems, you can take them equal as one, like for the ideal transformer model as a power interface. However, stability cannot be guaranteed even with this ideal interface. Therefore, you have to apply countermeasures to achieve simulation stability. There are many countermeasures possible. Some of them are highlighted right now. What we focus on, and what is basically in every power hardware in the loop system in reality, is some kind of feedback signal filtering. So the feedback signal, which is for voltage type interfaces, the current, and for current type interfaces, the voltage, as the duality of electrical system is valid also for the PHL, you can always apply this. What we will see here, if you go into the next slide, that in terms of current filtering, in the feedback signal, there is a transfer function. So the filter is modeled by a transfer function, which is valid for the spectral approach of a simple low pass filter, which is 1 divided to 1 plus S divided to 2 PF, the corner frequency FC. And by choosing or designing the filter related to the corner frequency FC, you can limit the system bandwidth, as it is used in many or basically all electrical systems or electronic systems. And therefore, if you don't allow the system to go to very high bandwidths, which always leads to instabilities at some point, but if you limit it to low bandwidths, system will get stable at some point. And it has to be identified when it will get stable and how. So the model of the block diagram is shown in the lower graph here. See here on the hardware side or on the software side, a dynamic model of the anti-aliasing filter and also of the feedback filter can be inserted in this model, and then the open loop transfer function will be the same as was shown some slides before. So the T filter will be included into the open loop transfer function, and this is impacting a lot the the open loop transfer function of the closed loop system. Okay, so another method which was developed by AIT and NTUA, so Panos Kotsompopoulos made a stay at AIT, and we developed this kind of shifting impedance method where we try to shift parts of the impedance from the software side to the hardware side and vice versa in order to gain stability. So as we said before, the ratio of the system impedances is decisive for stability of this PIGL simulation. And what we said, we want that the complete system reacts the same as it was before. So we have to determine the voltage ratios of software and hardware sides towards the power interfaces. And we inserted this RSH and XSH, which is a shifting impedance on the hardware side, shifted hardware impedance. It is called this block here on the right of the picture. And this impedance, which is inserted in hardware as real line impedance or whatever, must be subtracted from the software in order to get the same system behavior. This calculation of the shifted impedance of the software side and the equivalent part of the Thevenin equivalent on the software side is very important. You have to take into account the voltage differences of the voltage levels. So if you have the same voltages on the soft and hardware, like let's say low voltage, then it will be one. However, if you simulate a middle or high voltage networks or industrial voltage networks, you have to take this factor alpha or A. So this means the voltage on the software side towards the voltage on the hardware side into account. The same is valid for the apparent power. So if you simulate those devices and scale up the power on the software or on the hardware side, you have to take this into account. Otherwise, the simulation will not give you the same results. So this partial shifting impedance method is guaranteeing you stability to a certain point of view. You can calculate a minimum value of this shifted hardware impedance, which gives you a stable PHL running system. And so these are two methods exemplarily shown in order to stabilize power hardware loop systems. And by that, I guess I go forward and give the microphone and the floor to Efren, correct?
Thanks, George. So there's different interface topologies that we typically use on power hardware in the loop. The typical ones are the ones presented in here. So the ideal transformer method is the first one where you just use a voltage source on the hardware side and a current source to feedback the measurement on the simulation side. And you can get the transfer functions for this implementation and also assess the stability of this method. This can be assessed using simulation models, like building a model like presented in here. So there's other methods like the partial circuit duplication and also the damping impedance method. So the typically used interface topologies are typically the ideal transformer method because it's the simplest one and has good accuracy and stability under large number of scenarios. And also the damping impedance method. Also for the damping impedance method, basically you have a damping impedance that need to be very similar to the impedance of the hardware under test in order to be accurate. So that's one of the limitations, but nowadays there's some online impedance detection methods that actually measure the hardware under test impedance and can feed that impedance into the simulation. So this can make it stable. But in terms of interface communication, it needs to exchange a larger number of signals, and it's a bit more complicated to be implemented. So typically, ideal transformer method and damping impedance method are the use interface topologies. And then if we go into the accuracy, so George has explained, I mean, one of the constraints of power hardening the loop being the stability and some of the countermeasures to achieve a stable power hardening the loop simulation. And once you achieve a stable power hardening the loop simulation, basically the next thing you will have to check is the accuracy of your implementation. So this is the other constraint that we can have on power hardening the loop implementations. So basically you need to check if the accuracy is enough for the scenario that you want to test, for the power component that you want to validate. So mainly, typically the accuracy on power hardening the loop depends on the time delay of the implementation. So the different components on the power hardening the loop, the power interface, the communication, the real-time simulator, the measurement, they all add some delay into the loop. So this need to be we need to be aware of those delays, and if possible, we need to compensate for those delays in order to have an accurate simulation. Also, in the same manner, any filtering used for different purposes, like stability, as has been presented by George with a low-pass filter on the feedback path, and some anti-aliasing, because when we use analog communication, you have the analog to digital and digital to analog converters that usually they have some anti-aliasing filter and some other filters for noise. Also the accuracy of the simulated models. So this can affect also obviously to the accuracy of the whole implementation. Also amplifiers, they have limited bandwidth. So that also affects the accuracy. Other gain introduced by other components such as measurements, introducing some smaller gains. And again, the measurement accuracy. So if we go to the next slide, so basically, what's the difference between an ideal scenario and a power hardening the loop scenario? So basically, we have that interface that has been inserted between the simulation and the hardware under test. So basically, that's the main thing that we need to be aware of. So that interface is introducing all the stability and accuracy issues. So we need to recognize why and how is that affecting to the power hardening the loop. So in this case, there's an example with a switch mode interface, but also analog interfaces are inserted in the middle between the power system and the hardware under test. And they need to communicate with both of the sides, and all those interactions are basically affecting to the accuracy. And as example, a linear amplifier, it's typically better than switch mode amplifier because it's very low time delay, but it has very large losses at high powers and can also have bandwidth limitations. And with switch mode amplifiers, we have typically larger time delays. We have complex control that can add some inaccuracies as resonance and some interactions with the hardware under test. And the same, it can have also some bandwidth limitations. As I said, communication is required. So there's different types of communications, analog and digital, that can be used. Analog is using larger time delays because of the digital to analog conversions required. Digital communications are, they require lower, they have low, very low time delays. So I think it's a better type of communication. So we also have measurements and filters that they need to be analyzed, and they have larger time delays. So on the next slide, we have an example where accuracy has not been taken into account. So basically, we have an experiment where we are just testing a resistive load bank just to show how inaccurate can go a power hardening the loop simulation and why we need to take into account the different components that are part of this simulation. So we have a resistive load bank. We have, in the simulated part, we have some fifth and seventh harmonic on the voltage that then will be present on the current also. And we measure a time delay of around 900 microseconds. and also a notch filter on the power amplifier was used. So this notch filter, basically, it was used to show how inaccurate it can be. It's introducing a very large time delay, and also if you have harmonics for the larger harmonics, the time delay is even increasing. So as you can see in there, you know, voltage and current should be in phase because it's just a resistive load bank. So if you don't have the PHEL implementation, it should be in phase. But in this case, you can see how it's shifted, and also the harmonics doesn't make sense as with the ideal ones. So this is just to show that PHIL implementation should be assessed and the inaccuracy should be compensated for. So this typically can be done by compensated time delays or avoiding unnecessary filters, like in this case. And so basically one of the techniques that we can use to improve PHIL simulation accuracy is to compensate for this time delay that we typically encounter due to the interface and the communication. So basically, one proposal that has been developed at the University of Strathclyde is to compensate the time delay by shifting the time domain signal. So basically, the time domain signal received on the power interface to be amplified is transformed into the frequency domain, and then the time delay can be compensated by adding that phase that the time delay is adding in each of the harmonics. So not only the fundamental, but this phase is added harmonic by harmonic. And then this is reconstructed back in the time domain and then is amplified. So in this way, we compensate for the time delay, we improve the accuracy, so then active and reactive power of the hardware under test are the ones that we want and are not inaccurate. So this will be basically accurate during steady state and dynamic scenarios, but we also need to make sure that we understand that, I mean, in order to make the transformation from the time domain to the frequency domain, we are using DFTs that need one cycle, and then for transient scenarios, maybe it's not as highly accurate as if this is not used, but for dynamic and steady state scenarios, this would be good. So, I mean, this is some of the approaches have been shown how this can be improved, but there's other approaches on the literature that have been used as the use of other interface algorithms. In the previous case, we are using ideal transformer method, but damping impedance method, if the damping impedance is calculated properly, it can also improve the accuracy. So multi-rate simulation, some introduction of high-pass filter or leading transfer functions have been also used, and they should be used to improve accuracy. And then the limitations. So assuming some of the stability and accuracy constraints are already solved with some of the mentioned methods, there will still be some constraints regarding power hardware in the loop simulations. This can be the bandwidth of the power amplifier. So even if we try to compensate time delays and if we achieve a stable system with some of the methods, we still need the bandwidth of the amplifier and of the simulators to be highly enough in order to test some type of scenarios with like high switching frequencies or high harmonics. And also it's been proven to be very difficult to mathematically assess the stability under complex scenarios. So under simple scenarios, we can use different equations, but when a very complex scenario is there, it's very difficult to assess. And also some interactions when you use switch mode amplifiers, it can be a limitation. However, as I said, only limited scenarios will require very high bandwidth. Also, empirical assessment as a simulation, when you have a very complex scenario, you can build a simulation with the interface that you are planning on using. And if you can take into account all the delays and all the inaccuracies into this simulation, basically, you are able to assess the stability. And also we can obviously use some advanced converter controls in order to limit those interactions between amplifiers and hardware under test. So now, George again will introduce some of the power hardware in the loop experiments that the ERIGrid partners have been doing over the last time. So, George.
Thank you very much, Efren. So, I just wanted to present, you know, some slides about comparisons, hardware testing and digital simulation. So, what is the big difference between the pure hardware testing in laboratory and the PHL or CHL approach? This is why I chose this first slide. You can see here quite complex test setup in reality. You can see the photo on the right top. So you have several devices under test. You have inductances, resistances, not one of them, but multiple one of them if you include more active components into your hardware side. So then you get the multiple input, multiple output simulation. And the whole test setup in a laboratory is quite demanding, complex, and also you have to take into account that you have to you cannot change certain parameter like the air coil, the L, the inductance, what you see in the picture, it's fixed. In a power hardware in the loop simulation, you can change them. So this setup is transformed into a power hardware in the loop simulation if you look at the next slide. And everything will be much more easy and different. So here on the top, you see the picture how it was run in a numerical simulation. So you just simulate the whole grid, all impedances, all active devices in offline simulation in with models. And on the bottom, you see the power hardware in the loop setup. So the VROP, the VROPS is the virtual rest of the power system, is all run on the digital real-time simulator. And the power interfaces, power interface 1 and 2 on the bottom, these are the power interfaces with power amplifiers with only 2 hardware devices included into the simulation. So this is a big, big advantage for PHL and also CHL that you and have only 2 hardware devices and all the rest of the power system can be simulated. It can be very flexible and for the entire simulation of this topology, what is presented here and in the slide before, you need 1 or 2 single phase units, 4 or 5 kilowatts, connected to different nodes. Those grid impedances, they are defined. If you go back to the last slide, please. They are defined on the bottom. So the parameter of impedances on different nodes are defined with resistance and reactance. And those ones, so we have chosen these impedances because we have it in the laboratory in hardware. However, for software and PHL, you can vary them to arbitrary values. Okay, so if you jump to the next slide and now to the next. With this setup, we have the possibility to investigate a lot of constellations and topologies in the grid. We have in total 5 inverters connected to the grid in different locations. So with the use case 1 before, it was the inverter 1 and 5, so with different nodes. This one, which is use case 2, we have 2 inverters connected to the same node, so L1 and neutral. And for all those inverters, we want to see the behavior of those advanced control functions of grid-connected inverters according to state-of-the-art standards, which take those characteristic curves of Q and U, so volt VAR control, and how they are reacting, going from dead band to linear to the linear area, and then from the linear area to the saturation area, and the way back. So this behavior was the one we wanted to look at and validate with real hardware experiments, then numerical experiments, and PHL testing. And if you go to the next slide, you see the use case 3, which is presented. Here we have 1 inverter connected to L1 and another one on the same node A connected to L2. So there we have interferences via the neutral conductor. And in this case, we do have the same characteristic curves for both inverters. We just wanted to, so the green one is inverter 2. This has fixed operation. Inverter 1 is making the transition from the deadband area to the linear area. So these are scenarios. There are multiple ones, multiple others we've tested. I want to show these ones exemplarily. And now coming to the tests in the next slide for use case 1, you can see here, always on the within the next 3 slides, the setup is the same. On the left, you see the volt var, so the reactive power over voltage, with the black solid black line as the Q of U characteristic, and the blue line is the trajectory of the Q of U control, the volt var control. You've also seen the setups of the gradient delta Q versus delta T is 200% per second. So this is the gradient. And the average time was 1 cycle, so 20 milliseconds, 1 grid cycle. And for all those experiments, we could see here what is happening. On the right side, you see in the top the voltage, the time-dependent voltage, and on the bottom, the active and the reactive power, as well as the apparent power for this experiment. And for very slow rays of grid voltages, we see that the trajectories are running on the characteristic curve. So these are all controlled states. Everything is fine. In the next slide, with use case 2, we applied forced dynamic tests with grid voltage changes. So on the top picture, you see those very fast and faster oscillating grid voltages. And because of these very fast changes, on the left side in the Q of U diagram, you see that the trajectory is leaving the characteristic curve and going into uncontrolled states. So this one could be also seen with real hardware testing. We also saw this kind of behavior with power hardware in the loop, of course. However, it was not given. It was not given from the beginning of the experiment that we see the same, but depending on the bandwidth, what we could apply for the test, which was roughly 1.5 kilohertz, we could see the same behavior. In use case 3, you see here that with certain applies of changes of the active power and also of the grid voltage, we can see at some point some oscillations and instabilities. So uncontrolled states, as we see on the left, are also given here when we see those blue dots and the trajectory, which is not really running on the characteristic curve, but there are deviations. So all points which are not on the characteristic curves are per se and defined as uncontrolled states. So this oscillative behavior was also verified in laboratory experiments, and for this very, very high control settings with an average time of 23 seconds and 200% gradient, we could detect some instabilities. So power hub in the loop simulations are valid and suitable for verifying those behaviors, and this is why we take them at a certain point of time. Then we also made a test together with Panos Kotsompopoulos at AIT. It was 2 years ago. We established a quite complex network in software, which includes an HV network, a quite powerful with a short circuit power of 1 gigavolt ampere, then including a transformer, which transforms the voltage to middle voltage, and an onload tap changer. Then on the hardware side, we have a grid connected inverter, which was basically an active component, but scaled up in power this is referred to the slide, what I said before, to the shifting impedance method. So we scaled it up to higher power levels. And with this, can you show the full slide? Yeah, thanks. And with this, you see here that depending on the method what you apply, we see here that with the simulation, with the power hard in the loop simulation, we see some oscillations as it was shown in the slide before. However, with the numerical simulation, which includes the model of the grid connected inverter and not the real hardware, we cannot see any oscillations. So there might be problems here with the real case, the field application, what we cannot see in the numerical simulation. This is why power hard in the loop has a big advantage in terms of validation of some scenarios. Also, we could see some differences with the TAP simulation. With PHL, we only had one. With the numerical simulation, we had two TAPs. So if you want to see more information, just go to the paper, which is highlighted on the bottom. It was published in 2015 in Transaction of Industrial Electronics.
Yes, thank you, Georg. So now I move on with a presentation by Fraunhofer Ives. Ron Brandl could not join us today, so I'm presenting on his behalf. So you can see a part of the laboratory with the power amplification units, the real-time simulation, and some renewable energy units. In the simulation, you can see this is the IEEE 9 bus transmission system consisting of three synchronous generators, and one generator is gradually replaced by a renewable energy unit, which represents a wind turbine, a generation unit. So several tests are performed when the wind park, which is the hardware, replaces 0%, basically it is not there, or 10%, 20%, 30% of generation one. So at the case of 30%, the wind park generates 30% of the power, and the synchronous generator the rest 70%. And the load shading is applied, and we can monitor the active power at several buses, where we can see some oscillations, and we can also see the active power of the hardware under test on the right bottom side at the different cases. These oscillations will be explained next. We can see at this case the active power and the frequency graph. The wind turbine is operating with virtual inertia. This means that it responds to the rate of change of frequency of the system. And we can see that at the reference scenario, which means with no wind generation, the frequency deviations are larger. They start from around the 50.6 until 49.8, or more or less. But at the red line, with the more contribution by the wind park, the frequency deviations are significantly less. Moreover, on the right figure, we can see that at the case with high power by the wind turbine, which is again the red line, the oscillations are damped faster. So we can see that the virtual inertia can improve the stability at this case, and the higher contribution shows how frequency stability support. Then another test case is examined, which is the power recovery rate after low voltage right through. So basically when there is, for example, a fault in the network and the voltage is at the grid, there is this low voltage right through function required by the standards. But afterwards, there are different ways of recovering the active power back to the previous value. So in this case, again, the hardware under test is a simulated wind park model, which fully replaces generator one. So if we go back a few slides, generator one, this one is replaced fully by the wind turbine, which is the hardware device. And the short circuit occurs at some bus. And we can see, we examine three cases. One, the reference is without the wind park. Case two is with fast power recovery rate after the low voltage right through. And the third one is the slow recovery rate, which is the one required by current standards. For example, FGWTR3, which requires 10% per second, which is a low value. Yeah. So we can see the voltages at all the nodes of the network at the three scenarios that I mentioned. And we can see that at the slow scenario, after the default, the voltage rises, but then it decreases again, and it is quite low at steady state. This is explained by what happens also on the frequency of the system, that I will show at the next slide. So we can have a look at the frequency. We can see that at the reference scenario, which means with no wind turbine, and at the fast scenario, the frequency leads to a steady state value. However, when the slow settings are present, which are those required by the current standard, the frequency does not lead to steady state. Yeah, so it increases too much. So basically we have an instability case here. We can also hear the active power at the three cases. So at the slow case, you can see that in the blue line, the active power is recovering very, very slowly, with a very slow rate. And we can see clearly that with these faster settings, we have a better response of the system concerning both frequency and voltage. And also the DR can provide fast recovery rates because these are just some settings which can be applied at the inverter. And it is better to use these fast settings. Now I move on to some experiments performed at the UA. This is a combined control hardware-in-the-loop and power hardware-in-the-loop test of an off-grid microgrid controller. So there is a controller, a central controller, which takes some measurements from the power system. In this case, the power system simulated in the RTDS consists of a synchronous generator, some loads, and PV production. This is basically an isolated system. So the controller takes some of the measurements and according to its own algorithm, sends it points to the SCADA system to add some loads. So the idea is that the controller activates these dump loads so that the minimum load ratio of the diesel generator is respected. Because when you have high PV generation, you can have this limit can be exceeded, this 30% limit of the synchronous generator. And at the first figure, we can see the active power before doing the dumping, which is the red line, and the dashed line is the 30% of the nominal power of the synchronous generator. So at this case, the limit would be clearly exceeded. However, when we use the dump loads, we can see the blue line that more or less we are able to keep this 30% limitation. At the figure below, with the green line, we can see the dump load which was activated, which consists of different steps, of different loads that are added based on the operation of the control algorithm. And we can also see the frequency that it is highly improved due to the integration of this dump load. And I would like to show here that the non-ideal operation of the dump load shows the benefit of using the combination of control hill and the PHIL, because we can see how the real system will behave, and it's not an ideal thing. As we can see, the blue line at the first figure is not exactly at the 30%, but there are also some deviations due to the limitations of the real hardware that we had in the lab. Now, move on to some experiments that we are doing for laboratory education, again at MPUA. You know, in general, there is this tendency of doing everything in digital, in the digital world. So many laboratories for students' education have been converted to PC labs in the last decades. So what we're trying to do is to bring back the students to the hardware lab and to let them gain some hands-on experience. So PHIL is an ideal tool for doing this. And we applied the double PHIL configuration so that we can have two test benches. And we simulated the equipment that was not available. So you can see the equipment that was operating in the lab and the two workbenches of the students, where each student, each group of students of five or six students had in front of them an inverter, an oscilloscope or power analyzer, and a computer where they could make several operations and take measurements. So I now give the word again to a friend, Giulio Sansano from the University of Strathclyde, to continue.
Thank you, Panos. So here are some more applications that have been tested on Grenoble IMP by using power hardware in the loop. Here we can see some wind energy testing of system behavior as control, same as for electrical vehicle to grid integration. So in here we try to analyze how the vehicle to grid affects to the system, and also try to test the controls of this vehicle to grid. Similar for PV integration and intelligent house energy management. So it shows how PHIL. So yeah, as I was saying, this some of the applications you can see here. And then another, on the next slide, we have a very interesting application that was tested at Grenoble also. So they patented a three-position commutator for monophase inverters. And so in this case, they were trying to reduce the negative effect of connecting PV power to the grid by switching to the best phase to inject according to what smart meters data. So by getting the data of the smart meters, and they were able to decide on what phase to inject the power from PVs. And that's the power hardware in the loop implementation you can see in this figure, where they're using RTLab as the real-time simulator. Then they're using a power amplifier, 18 kVA, and then as the hardware under test, they have the cap device and an inverter. And the inverter set points are also emulated by the real-time simulator. In the next slide, we can see some of the results of this study. So you can see the simulation results on the left and the power hardware in the loop experiment on the right. So this shows that the cap, this cap system helps to reduce the system instability. And so in this case, the variation of the voltage is reduced to less than 2%, so less than the limit. Like, so the cap is helping to reduce this limitation. And as expected, so power hardware in the loop test, it gives a more realistic behavior and variation than the pure simulation. So demonstrating the benefit again of power hardware in the loop, when you can see those variations that you cannot see on pure simulations. So now we are going to talk a bit on so what ERIGrid is doing regarding hardware in the loop and power hardware in the loop. So currently we have two main activities for improving real-time simulation and hardware in the loop methods. And also some activities on standardization and interoperability of hardware in the loop experiments. So the first improvement or extension, I would say, of hardware in the loop we are considering is to integrate hardware in the loop could be like controller hardware in the loop or power hardware in the loop into co-simulation framework. So try to combine co-simulation, offline co-simulation with hardware in the loop. And the other one is to improve power hardware in the loop performance by trying to solve those issues of a very complex stability assessment or time delay compensation and accuracy improvements. And regarding the standardization, just trying to define a general framework for smart grid for the hardware in the loop. So why are we working on trying to integrate co-simulation to hardware in the loop? So nowadays there's an increase in like more people wants to see how, let's say, multi-vector energy scenarios or multi-domain simulations. So how, as example, communications can affect power system behaviors, or how different energy types can affect the electrical system domain. So by integrating co-simulation with hardware in the loop, we will hopefully be able to assess some of these scenarios. Also for compatibility with larger models, so and different software running in different time steps. So typically we are limited to real-time simulators, but what if we can introduce larger models with different smaller, larger time steps to be interacting with these smaller time steps, so we can check the behavior of like larger systems and different devices and domains. And so this will allow for a complete view of the behavior of the different domains. So we are working on three different approaches for this integration. The first one is a offline co-simulation, where we are trying to convert this simulation into FMU, is a functional mockup units, and integrate directly into the real-time simulator model. So this will force it to run at real-time simulation time steps, but this need compatibility verification. So it's still like we are doing some work in this just now. The second approach is co-simulation with real-time simulation without synchronization. So it's basically an asynchronous simulation between offline and real-time simulation. In this case, there's an example of the lab link architecture that has been mainly developed by AIT. And basically we have some offline simulation that are integrated with real-time simulation by means of an interface that is called LabLink that manages to couple offline with real-time simulation that at the same time can be again coupled to a controller hardware in the loop or a power hardware in the loop setup. And the third one is a synchronized co-simulation approach with hardware in the loop. So in this case, this solution has been developed by iOS mainly, and it's called OpSim. The synchronization is made via a conservative approach. So that means all the components, all the simulations need to wait for the last simulation to finish the time step in order to be synchronized. So this is the conservative approach. So this environment may be extended with physical laboratory, and it also can communicate with OpalRT with an asynchronous interface similar to the lab link. So regarding the improvement that we are working on ERIGrid, so the first one is the assessment of the stability. So we are developing a method for determining marginal parameters to achieve stability for power hardware in the loop. So this has been developed by considering both the stability criterion. As for a stable simulation, this condition shown here has to be satisfied. So with these equations where the gain needs to be less than one and the phase equal to pi, by using these two equations, we can find out the marginal parameters to achieve stability. So we can find out what's the maximum delay of that setup in order to be stable. And this method has been successfully applied to the shifting impedance method and feedback filter shown before. So with this method, it's quite easy to see if your system is going to be stable or not. And if it's not stable, you can detect what's the marginal parameter, so you can try to make it stable by changing those parameters. And also the other improvement method is based on the time delay. So as we said before, time delay is very important for the accuracy. We can see that the waveform is typically displaced because of the delay. And at the same time, the delay also has an effect on stability. You can see there a Nyquist plot of the open loop with different time delays, so from 700, 400, and 100. And you can see how the stability margin is being reduced as the time delay is increasing. They are closer to the instability point. So first thing, before compensating, we need to make sure that the time delay is reduced as to the minimum, so we can have a larger stability margin. And then once the time delay is reduced to the maximum, then we will try to implement a compensation method. So in this case, ERIGrid is also working in this time delay compensation method. That basically how we try to compensate it, as mentioned before, is we do a parallel DFT for the number of harmonics that we want to compensate, and we basically that will transform the time domain into a frequency domain signal, and then we perform the phase shift, we reconstruct that signal and amplify that. And at the moment, this is done on the power interface, so on the control, on the real-time target of the control for our power amplifier, we are using this algorithm to compensate for the time delay. Although this could also be used on a separate device, maybe on the feedback measurements, the feedback measurement, this could also be added. So this will help to improve stability and accuracy, as we've shown. And it has relatively low computation by using this parallel DFT rather than just a DFT or FFT. And this could compensate fundamental and harmonic components. So the activities we are going on regarding standardization of firewall in the loop. Can we change the slide? So activities on the standardization, so mainly methodological and technical improvements of ERIGrid workgroup are formalized and presented in various research papers. So we are trying to have like good publications presenting this technical and methodological work. So we are trying to work together with the IEEE Task Force on Power Hardware in the Loop. And at the same time, we are preparing a yellow paper on hardware in the loop. This yellow paper is similar to a white paper, but I think it's more research focused. So as conclusions for this workshop, so we think that research on smart grid technologies require some advanced testing and simulation methods for its validation. So we've proved that power hardware in the loop can be one of these advanced testing techniques, as it de-risks field tests by enabling reality close testing in controlled laboratory environments. So the cost and the risk of performing PHIL is much less than doing like a real field test. Also, power hardware in the loop can reveal interactions which are not visible at pure digital simulations, that has been shown on some of the examples. So we also consider that more research is needed on the stability and accuracy of PHIL simulations, as some of the scenarios could go unstable or not be accurate enough. So some of these methods should be improved. And we also think that some standardized approach for performing power hardware in the loop is required. So there's different terminologies and different ways of performing PHIL, but in order to move forward, I think we need a more standardized approach in order to perform this power hardware in the loop. And also we think that combining hardware in the loop and co-simulation can also be an important steps towards the holistic testing of smart grid systems. So those are the main conclusions we can draw from this presentation. And I mean, we thank you for your attention, and I think now we are going to move on to the live test, real power hardware in the loop test. I think, Panos, are you there?
Yes, Efren, thank you. So now we move on to the live demo. I'm here with my colleague Marios Maniatopoulos from NTUA, and we will do this live for you. Okay, just very fast, this is a lab sim of our lab, which consists of three microgrids, RTDS, power amplifiers, intelligent load controllers. And you can see us here with the RTDS, the amplifiers, the microgrid, and the PV simulator. And we're going to do two live demonstrations, two tests. One is the PHIL testing of island power system, and the other one is the combined control CHIL and PHIL testing of centralized coordinated voltage controller. So at the first case, in simulation, we have a synchronous generator, some lines and loads. We have a hardware PV inverter, which operates with a PF droop control. So when the frequency increases, it decreases its active power. And we also have a simulated storage system, which provides a virtual inertia. So let's hardware in the loop. So at our lab, we are using the, we have an rack of the RTDS. We can see the draft, which is the environment where we you know, design the system. You can see the synchronous generator, the loads, and this current source represents the hardware under test. We can also have a look at the inputs and outputs. So this is the voltage measured from the RTDS, which after some scaling, it gets to the digital to analog converter of the RTDS. And similarly, the current of the hardware under test is measured at this card, and it is then applied to the control algorithm. We have also applied some over voltage and over current protections here, so that we ensure that in case of instability, that we do not destroy our hardware under test and our equipment. And now we move on to the other environment of the platform, where we monitor and control everything. So now Marios has set the voltage to the hardware inverter. So on the left, you can see the voltage, which is 230 RMS. And the current, we need to wait for some more time so that the inverter gets connected. And when this is done, we're going to check both the amplitude of the current and also the phase of the current, because some mistakes can take place if we do some improper scaling or if we put the cables in the opposite direction. We can have some instability and some other problems. So these are things that have happened to us in practice. So we have also developed like a standard procedure to do this smoothly in order to avoid any problems. Okay, so now we have current from the inverter. We can see it here. And we check that everything is okay, and we close the loop using this switch. So now this current is sent back to the simulation, and we have PHIL. Yeah? We can also have a look at the hardware measurements. So with the purple line, we can see the voltage reference sent from the RTDS to the amplifier. With the yellow line, we can see the actual voltage, 230 volts, produced by the power amplifier, and with the green line, we can see the power provided by the PV inverter right now.
So we now go back to the RTDS, and we are going to do the tests, which are basically tasks that concern the frequency control. So we're going to remove part of the load using a switch, and we're going to monitor the frequency response at three cases. So at first case, we removed the load, and the frequency is increased, around 5.6 is the maximum value, and the steady state value is around 50.45. And the active power of the inverter, after apart some dynamic effect, it gets it's more or less constant. Yes, so there is no smart algorithm right now. So afterwards, we send a command to the hardware inverter to operate with the PF droop control. So when the frequency increases, it will reduce its active power. Don't have a look at the screen now. We're just doing some initialization actions. So are we ready? Yeah, OK. So then we have sent a command to the inverter via its web interface. And we do again the same load setting. And we can see that the frequency at steady state is reduced. It is now at 50.4. And this is because the active power of the inverter is reduced. Yeah, we can clearly see this. This is the active power of the hardware inverter as we measure it in the RTDS. The next experiment includes the activation of virtual inertia of the simulated storage system. So again, not look at the screen, yeah, please. We're doing some initialization. The active power of the storage system is proportional to the rate of change of frequency. So this is a faster algorithm. And we did again the load setting, and we can now see that the maximum frequency is decreased. Before it was 50.6, now it is 50.5, more or less. Yes, so we can have a better frequency response at the dynamic conditions. So if we go back to some slide where I have these experiments together, yeah, we can see with the black line the case with no control. With the red line, we have the activated only the droop control, so that we can see that in steady state, the frequency response is improved. But then we also apply the inertia, and at the blue line, we can see also that the power at the dynamic conditions, no, at the frequency also at the dynamic conditions is closer to the nominal value. And with this test, we would like to demonstrate that this is a system level testing. So in the conventional way, we could just have a PV simulator and a grid simulator and apply some frequency profiles in order to test the behavior of the inverter. However, with PHIL, we do not only test the inverter, but we also test its impact on the system. In this case, we see how the frequency of the system behaves. Also, I would like to note that to have the full hardware implementation would be rather challenging with all the synchronous generators and storage systems, etc. And now we can move on to the second case, where we have a distribution network, and we deal with the optimal voltage, coordinated voltage control, in order to deal with voltage rise problems. So we have a central algorithm which gets several measurements from the network and then sends commands to some devices. Yeah. So you can see the network here simulating the RTDS. We have a hardware controller which gets all the measurements and sends the set points. And we also have a hardware inverter. So it is a combination of control hill and P hill. And now Marius needs some time to prepare this, so I will give you some more information on this. So obviously this is a centralized coordinated voltage control. The transient optimization algorithm, which aims to minimize
three values. The first one is to minimize all the voltage deviations. The second is to minimize the power losses, and also to minimize the tap changes of the OLTC. So for our case, we are using the benchmark low voltage network, which is proposed by SIGRE, but we have done some modifications so that it is more appropriate for our test. We have first of all introduced a non-load tap changer, which is not there at the original network. And we have also increased the PV generation so that we have a bigger voltage rise problem at the network. And we have also done this with pure simulation, control hardware in the loop, and also a combination of control hardware in the loop and power hardware in the loop. In this way, we can have more realistic results because more equipment is hardware. So we could also do this without a hardware PV inverter. But with this component, we can get also more realistic results. And the problem we're going to see is that we have some overvoltage conditions due to high radiation. We examine a time at more or less at midday, where the load is at some medium value. So these are the, you can now see the screen. These are the voltages. These are the voltages of all the buses. So we can clearly see that we have some over voltage conditions at all the buses. And this is without the operation of the control. Now Marius will activate the control algorithm. And we're going to see the operation of the system and the voltages, the reactive power, the tap changes, and everything. So we need to wait a little bit. And we can see clearly that at first the voltage is reduced because of the reactive power absorption of the inverters. And at around 6 seconds, we can see the first tap change of the OLTC. And then we also have a second tap change. And this operation leads to improved voltages. We can also see here the reactive power absorption of all the PV inverters. And the blue line is the behavior of the hardware inverter. So we can see that this is different than the other ones. The basic difference is that there is a time delay due to the communication, because the controller sends a set point, which is not delivered directly. So we have this delay, which is not taken into account at the simulation, and also there is a different ramp rate of the inverter. And we can also see the active and reactive power of the simulated storage system. Before finishing, we'd like to show you some more results that if we have a 24-hour operation, we can see that the voltages are clearly improved. And I think that's enough from our side, because we would like to have 15 minutes of discussion. Apologies for being a bit out of schedule. And we would like to hear what are your comments and remarks at this point. And thank you again for your attention.
Great stuff, thank you. What will be the next steps?
So a friend presented at his slides the ERIGrid approach to hardware in the loop. So basically we are working on combining it with co-simulation, which is one point. And also we're doing some research on improving the stability of the approach, and also the standardization, which is also an important issue. A friend made a presentation on this, so I don't know, I don't think it's meaningful to say everything again.
So if you want something more specific, please let us know.
Panos, this is Georg Laus from AIT. I think Hermann mentioned what's next. From my side, I can just inform the community that we are working a lot within the task force of real-time simulation on more scientific issues, and also with the P2004 working group. It's an IEEE working group, maybe some of you may know. We're working a lot towards standardization of hardware-in-the-loop testing of power apparatus. So these are our next steps where we are heavily involved in. Also, ERIGrid is a big partner of these two IEEE working groups. And yeah, if you I write the link in the chat that everyone can see it and join meetings there. So the working group P2004 is established this year, and we especially focus on recommended practice guidelines, so standardization documents, bringing hardware into the loop into standardization frameworks.
Yeah, thank you, Georg. I think that's exactly what I meant. What can we do from here on, and perhaps jointly, or, you know, because I think this was a great webinar to get a lot of information, but probably things are not stuck here. So probably we'd like to move on. And that's, I think that was the direction of the question, actually.
So please, we are open and very happy to answer additional questions. So please come by and hit us.
So how long is ERIGrid running, and what will be any follow-up activities?
I don't know, maybe Thomas Strasser, who is the coordinator of ERIGrid, would like to share some more information and inform also of the possibility of visiting our labs free of charge in order to stay for some weeks and do experiments at the labs of all the ERIGrid partners.
Yeah, hello everybody. just one question. What do you mean with follow-up activities on this specific topic? Hardware in the loop simulation, power hardware in the loop simulation, or more in general?
I mean, well, yeah, I think the hardware in the loop things, in particular, I think. Well, general always, but I think hardware in the loop in particular.
Yeah, one of our core activities, and I think colleagues have already, or partners have already pointed this out, is one activity is especially related to improvement of the PL approach, focusing on accuracy and stability issues, and the other one is to combine it also with co-simulation. So that's our core activities in the ERIGrid, and as my colleague Georg pointed out, also going towards the direction of standardization. I think that's our one of our core activities here in the project. And yes, as Panos already briefly mentioned, we have here the possibility in the ERIGrid project to share our laboratories. Some of you have already applied for it for free. So we are providing our laboratory environment for free access, so you can apply for so-called user projects. That you mean if you have a certain problem, especially also on the hardware-in-the-loop simulation, power-hardware-in-the-loop simulation, you don't have such a comprehensive equipment that we can share in the project, then you can apply for a user project. You need to briefly summarize your plans, what you want to do, submit the proposal. So we have every 6 months a new call open. And these proposals need to be evaluated by an own evaluation board. And if this proposal is good enough, then you are invited to visit our laboratories, use the laboratories. You're being supported by local laboratory people in your validation activities, and ERIGrid pays your travel fees, your stay fees, so hotel fees, partly also a daily allowance. And so you don't need to pay for accessing the lab and for coming to the labs. On the other side, you need to report your findings in the corresponding labs, and this report will be published to the public. If you want to get more information, then please get in contact. Have a look at the project website under this transnational access menu point. It's on the website. You can find more details about this free offer for our laboratories. You can also see a selection of ongoing or partly completed user projects that have already successfully applied for this possibility. So you are kindly invited to use this possibility. I hope this this answers your questions.
Thank you very much. The question: how long does it last now, the ERIGrid? I mean, for how much time have we got in order to apply for such a user?
Yeah, project? We have the project is now running since 25 months, but we have additional 29 months open, so it's a 4.5 years project. So there's still plenty of time to apply for this kind of user projects. We have offered, we opened the next call middle of February next year. So currently, we have already accomplished 3 calls, and at least 3 calls are still open. So they open every 6 months in the future. So you find the details also on the project website under this transnational access menu point. You see also the timing of the calls, and if you have specific topics that you want to discuss with us, so please have a look. Get also in contact with the corresponding laboratories. You find all the laboratory description and contact information for each laboratory. Please get in contact with those laboratories where you have interest to apply for a user project. They can help you in preparing the proposals. These are not very long proposals, I would consider this short proposals. We have to briefly describe what you're planning to do. And I think the partners in the project are really interested to support you also in the proposal preparation phase. And we can already, I think, sort out potential questions. For sure, the description on the website is a kind of summary of the lab capabilities. It's quite difficult to describe every different every possibility, every service that we can offer in detail. It's often good to get in contact with the laboratory that you have interest.
Well, thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Thomas, for the nice explanations. Are there any additional questions or remarks? Yes. Apologies, Tommy. I cannot hear you very well. Again, it's not so clear.
Sorry, I think my mic isn't working that well, so I didn't write the question.
Yeah. At some point, it got better, but.
Okay, I can try and ask a question now.
Now it's better, yeah. Please.
As you said, over hardware loop stability. So how will that you make the protection on the hardware side?
So I'm not sure if I heard exactly the question. Is it how do we evaluate the stability of power hardware in the loop?
I'll write the question so it's easier. My mic isn't working that well.
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. In the meanwhile, I just want to say that I've set the link into the chat for the webinar today for the P2004 meeting. In case anyone is interested, you can copy this link and join us at 4 p.m. Central European time. And maybe in the meanwhile, Tommy can write his question into the web and we can answer it then.
So in the meanwhile, are there some additional questions? Yes. Yes, so Evangelos Doukakis is asking if we can get the presentation via email. So basically, we will send all the material and the recorded version of the webinar to all the people that have registered. There were several people interested from the US and Canada, but due to the time there is now, I don't know. I think that all of them are sleeping right now, so they could not join. So we will also send this presentation to them as well. Yes, I'm still waiting for the question of Tommy.
And Panos, one additional comment, and I think all the documents or the presentation and the recording will be also linked to the website.
For sure.
So this is available via the website as well.
Yes, this is the plan. But at first, we will send you the link to the people that have registered and participated to this event.
Please take me into this list. I registered late.
Yeah. Do we have, if there is someone that has not registered and is here, please send an email now to Marios Maniatopoulos, who was coordinating this, so that we can include you in the list. Yeah. His email appears in the announcement of the webinar. Okay, so one last question.
Panos, Tommy wrote the question into the chat room. Do you want to read it or should I?
Okay, I did not see it. Okay, yeah. So the question is, as the PHIL testbed is prone to instability, how have you made the hardware side protection? Very nice question. Just disconnect the simulation or some sort of I/O connection to hardware devices. Okay, so there are different approaches. I can say what we are doing. The other colleagues can say what they are doing. Basically, we have mainly software protections because software protections are faster. And even in case of instability, you can send the right values out of the RTDS, and so the hardware cannot experience any trouble. So we have some an overvoltage protection, overcurrent protection inside the RTDS, and in case these limits are exceeded, basically we open the loop, we send make the current coming from the hardware, we put it the value of zero. Yes, so basically we open the loop in this way. On the hardware side, we are just using some standard protection devices, nothing important. So I know that Georg are doing some additional things, so maybe he can share some more information with you.
Yes, basically we also use the software and the hardware protection. So we call it a software device, the software protection device, where we monitor all the currents and also the voltages in a closed loop scenario. And if we get some deviation, it's a little bit comparable to anti-islanding detection schemes. So we try to get the simulation in case of instability on the software side, because we can control it much faster, and then don't switch off, but bring the system into a stable and a safe state. For batteries, it's not going to work if you set the amplifier to zero, because this means maximum negative charge. but you have to identify the safe state of your PHL system and then trigger the safety device to this safe state. Otherwise, you will get you will trigger the hardware device, so the emergency stop, and you risk of some damage of the hardware.
So I hope, Tom, this response was okay. Also, AIT and the NTUA have written some papers where we describe this approach. Okay, so we have time for one more question. So I don't see any activities. So I would like to thank you again very much for joining today. I hope it was useful for your research. I also want to thank all the other colleagues of ERIGrid that we jointly developed this webinar. And as I said, we're going to send you the link with all the material. And we hope to see you again, preferably in a transnational access project or with some to gain access to our lab, if you like, but to our labs, if you like. And of course, we would be very happy to see you in all the other activities of our research community. So thank you very much for joining, and have a nice rest of the day.